Good afternoon, colleagues. Can I remind members that social distancing measures are in place in the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus? I ask that members take care to observe these measures, including when entering and exiting the Chamber. Please only use the aisles and walkways to access your seat and when moving around the Chamber. The next item of business is consideration of Business Motion 503 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a revision to today's business. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press their request to speak button now, and I call on Gillian Mackay to move the motion.
Moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I'm not seeing anybody who wants to... Mr Gibson, you're not pressing for this moment? No, thank you. No member has asked to speak against the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 503 be agreed. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is a statement by Marie Todd on cervical screening. The Minister will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Minister Marie Todd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I regret I am here to inform Parliament of a serious adverse event in the Scottish cervical screening programme. In December 2020, an NHS board conducted its annual invasive cervical cancers audit and discovered that a very small number of women had developed cervical cancer after being wrongly excluded from the screening programme following a hysterectomy carried out over 20 years ago. I'm extremely sorry to say that one of those women has died. Can I offer my sincere condolences and wholehearted sympathies to the women and their families and offer them the absolute reassurance that this government treats this issue with the utmost seriousness. The board has contacted those affected to apologise and to offer further discussions with clinicians. I know that this will be enormously distressing to them, and along with many of you, they will question how it happened. That's why I am now updating Parliament on what we know about the errors and how we are responding. To prevent causing undue anxiety and distress to the women involved, I have waited until the NHS has completed the first part of a national review before making this statement. Presiding Officer, these are complex matters, and I ask you and the members of the Chamber to have patience while I explain the background and nuances. The Scottish Cervical Screening Programme began in 1988 and routinely invites everyone with a cervix between the ages of 25 and 65 for regular tests. People may be invited up to the age of 70 to follow up a test that requires further investigation or treatment. Anyone who has had a total hysterectomy involving the complete removal of the uterus and the cervix can be excluded from screening, as there is no risk of cervical cancer. But those who have had a subtotal hysterectomy, where part or all of the cervix remains, should continue to be screened. This is true no matter how small the remaining part of the cervix is. While this will be of little comfort to the women and families affected, the incorrect exclusions were uncovered as part of our quality assurance processes, which require health boards in Scotland to conduct regular audits to review the cervical screening history of all patients diagnosed with cervical cancer. Once these exclusions were discovered, NHS National Services Scotland assembled an adverse event management team of senior gynaecologists, pathologists and public health experts, amongst others, to address the problem. At their direction, all NHS boards conducted an urgent review to assess the risk of other people having been incorrectly excluded. Unfortunately, this review confirmed there are instances where exclusions have been wrongly applied across Scotland. It also revealed that this is an extremely complex issue, spanning a number of decades and involving a variety of potential errors. The first hysterectomy-related exclusion dates back to 1959, almost 30 years before the screening programme began. I must say there is more to do to uncover the full extent of this issue, but I will update on what we know and has been done so far. Firstly, immediate remedial work to address the failure has been completed. NHS Scotland has strengthened procedures to ensure that the full details of hysterectomies, including whether or not the cervix was completely removed, are clearly recorded and communicated to the cervical screening programme. Secondly, no other routine audits to date in NHS boards have found any further instances where someone has developed cervical cancer after having been incorrectly excluded from the programme. Thirdly, the Adverse Event Management Group identified as an immediate priority a review of individuals who had been excluded from the cervical screening programme, but whose records indicate they had a subtotal hysterectomy. There are around 1,500 individuals in this group. Of these, around 500 had hysterectomies before 1997, which are recorded in an older part of the medical records system. Their records are being fully reviewed, but this is a time-intensive process and not yet complete. Today, therefore, I will focus on the audit of more recent records, but I assure you that work is proceeding urgently to review the records of those who had subtotal hysterectomies before 1997. I know how concerning this will be. I do not want to minimise the seriousness of this incident, but I do want to provide reassurance that the risks of cervical cancer are low. In the UK, fewer than 1 in 100, under 1% of women and people with a cervix will develop cervical cancer in their lifetime. And I hope the actions I outline now will demonstrate that we are doing everything possible to provide effective support for anyone who has been incorrectly excluded. At the direction of the Adverse Event Management Group, a multidisciplinary team was assembled in each NHS board to check the hospital records, laboratory records, GP records and screening records of everyone excluded from screening since 1997, despite having a subtotal hysterectomy recorded. That work is now complete. Of this group, over one third have been correctly excluded and no further action is needed. However, 220 individuals within the eligible age range for screening were excluded in error. The NHS has written to them individually to apologise, to explain the situation and to offer personalised advice. GP practices have been asked to prioritise each of them for a timely screening appointment, and I expect these to take place within a few weeks. There are also 149 individuals whose records are unclear about what type of hysterectomy was performed. Their health boards have written to them to explain and to apologise and to offer a gynaecological appointment and a screening test if appropriate. Similar letters have issued to 65 individuals who were incorrectly removed from the programme and who are now over the age range for screening. Where necessary, the Scottish Government has provided funding to health boards to run additional clinics so those requiring gynaecology appointments can be seen within the next 4 weeks without impacting on other services. A very small number of individuals have left Scotland. We are working with our UK counterparts to contact these people and advise on next steps. Lastly, 152 individuals within the group are now deceased. A full audit of these records is underway. I know that anyone who receives a letter about this may be extremely anxious, and I am sorry about that. The Scottish Government has provided additional funding to Joe's Trust so anyone who is concerned can contact them and receive free and comprehensive support. They can be contacted by calling 0808 802 8000 or emailing helpline@joestrust.org.uk. More information about cervical screening is available on NHS Inform. Work is also underway to consider the appropriateness of around 200,000 exclusions thought to have been based on total hysterectomies. I must stress that the vast majority of hysterectomies carried out in Scotland are total. Therefore, we can be confident that the majority of these are correct. However, Based on our current findings and the range of errors involved, I hope that members will agree it is prudent to look more closely at them. Once this work is complete, NHS health boards will write to anyone who requires further investigation. While I know people who have had hysterectomies may be concerned, I urge them to wait for this work to finish and not to contact health services in the meantime, unless they are worried that they have symptoms of cervical cancer. Finally, because we must learn from this incident and prevent future occurrences, we have alerted the other UK nations. We will work closely with them as investigations proceed. Before I conclude, I'll say a few words about the screening programme. While today's announcement will be worrying for those who have been directly affected and for others who have had a hysterectomy, screening continues to be the most effective way of preventing cervical cancer. Cervical screening is not a diagnostic test. It aims to detect cell changes before they become cancerous. It saves 5,000 lives in the UK every year and prevents 8 out of 10 cervical cancers from starting. This incident does not detract from that, nor does it take away from the quality of screening tests or their findings. In fact, it is because the screening programme is so effective that we are doing all we can to ensure that no one is excluded from it when they shouldn't be. If you're due to make or attend a cervical screening appointment, I urge you to do so. And if you haven't attended a screening before or missed your last test, please contact your GP surgery to arrange one. Meantime, I urge everyone, whether affected by this issue or not, to be alert for symptoms of cervical cancer. Anyone who is experiencing unusual discharge or bleeding after sex, between periods or after the menopause should contact their GP practice immediately and not wait for their cervical screening appointment. These symptoms are not usually caused by cervical cancer, but it is important to have them checked. Further information on symptoms is available on NHS Inform. Presiding Officer, this incident will be profoundly worrying to many people. For the women and families I referred to at the beginning of my statement, it has had devastating consequences. Nothing I can say can undo that. However, I commit to you today that everything we do surrounding this incident will be guided by three principles. Our focus will be on identifying and providing the appropriate support and care for anyone who has been wrongly excluded. We will be open, transparent, and welcoming of the scrutiny that this investigation rightly deserves, and we will learn from this so it cannot happen again. On that basis, I reiterate that our immediate priority is to ensure that screening or gynaecological appointments are offered to everyone already identified as having been incorrectly excluded. The audit of anyone excluded from the programme who had a subtotal hysterectomy before 1997 will continue, and I expect that anyone excluded in error will be contacted in August. And investigations into the other hysterectomy-based exclusions will continue. Wherever there is concern, we will act, and wherever further changes can make our processes more robust, we will implement them. I have offered meetings to opposition spokespeople. However, if any MSP would like to meet to discuss this issue, I am more than happy to do so over recess period. I will, of course, update Parliament again shortly after recess. Thank you.
Thank you. The Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we will have to move on to the next item of business. It would be helpful if members who wish to ask a question were to press their request to speak buttons now. And I call Annie Wells, who is joining us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank the Minister for her statement. What she has just shared with the Chamber is deeply distressing news, and my heart goes out to the family of the woman who has tragically lost her life and all those women affected. As the Minister says, many women will be concerned after today's revelations, and I echo her statement that anyone concerned should contact Joe's Cervical Cancer Trust. The Minister mentions that there were around 500 hysterectomies before 1997, which are recorded in an older part of the medical record system. Can I ask the Minister how long will it take for a full review into their records to be, and how long, and has any of them been completed already?
Minister.
Thank you, Annie Wells, and thank you for the question. The same adverse event management team that oversaw the review of the post-1997 group will continue to oversee the review into those who had their subtotal hysterectomies before 1997. This expert group includes very senior and very experienced clinicians, pathologists and public health experts. The work of auditing the records will be carried out by individual health boards, as was the case for the participants who had subtotal hysterectomies after 1997. This work has already begun, and I hope this work will be concluded by the end of July, and that those who are identified as wrongly excluded will be contacted very shortly after the work is completed.
Jackie Bailey.
Presiding Officer, this is of course an extremely serious situation, and our thoughts are with the women who have been affected. The truth is we do not yet know the full scale of this error, but it could impact on many more women than the 220 excluded from the screening programme since 1997. It is of course critical that women are contacted urgently and offered information and support. Can I ask the Minister, why was this not picked up by audits of the screening programme in the past? Can I also ask her, when all the women affected will not just be identified but be seen by a clinician, will there be additional specialist clinics in every health board area? And of course, she will be aware of the concerns already about capacity, a significant backlog in screening with something like 180,000 tests delayed because of the pandemic, and delays now of 6 months or even more for those who have been screened and need treatment. So can the Minister tell me what additional resources will be provided urgently to cope with this serious situation, as well as catching up with the backlog?
Minister.
Thank you, Jackie Bailey, and thanks for those questions. As I said in my statement, around 500 cases have, I think it's 434 people have been contacted this week. But because of the range of errors involved, we think it's very prudent to go back and examine the records of all women who've had hysterectomies, just to ensure that there have been no errors occurring. That means that the number of women who might be involved could be larger. I did say in my statement, though, that that number is about 170,000 women, but bearing in mind that the vast majority of women who have hysterectomies in Scotland have total hysterectomies, we expect that the vast majority of those women will have been correctly excluded. I know it's uncomfortable to have to wait to be contacted, but we are working as fast as we can to resolve this issue. In terms of additional resources, I would say... Yes, we recognise that this, I think in terms of general practice, the number involved is around 200 women have been asked to attend their GPs for a screen. I don't expect that to produce an undue burden on general practices. There'll be very few who have more than one woman involved. In terms of those two groups of women who have been called and given, they've had their letters and have been given an appointment at the hospital, we have provided extra resources to several health boards who wanted to put on additional clinics to ensure that that did not impact on the services currently being prescribed, provided. And in terms of the invasive cancer audits, the new national methodology was introduced in 2014. Health boards were doing audits before this, and I can only say that no cases have been found through that national audit system until 2020.
Gillian Martin, to be followed by Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Jackie Bailey raised some points that I wanted to mention as well, so I'll dig a little bit deeper. This is clearly worrying for women affected and their families, and I understand from the Minister's statement that women have now been contacted to take forward the next steps of their care. Should there be any woman who's concerned that they may have been affected and hasn't heard anything, can the Minister outline what supports in place for them to raise those concerns? The Minister mentioned Joe's Trust, but might that contact with them lead to referrals. And given that right now there are general concerns that GPs are not doing many face-to-face appointments, can you give reassurance that not only are affected when being contacted, but they're being given urgent and one-to-one personal in-person appointments?
Minister.
Thank you. So the women who are affected by, who have been wrongly excluded, have been contacted by letter. Those letters went out on Tuesday this week, so should have arrived yesterday or today. Those letters highlighted to the women that they were to telephone if they were required to make a GP appointment. They were to telephone and to highlight during that telephone call that they had been contacted by letter and wrongly excluded. We also sent letters to all of the GPs of those women, and we have briefed a whole variety of professional groups, including medical directors, directors of public health, NHS boards, NHS executive directors of nursing, GPs, Royal College of Obstetricians and Gynaecologists, Royal College of GPs, Royal College of Nursing, and cervical screening programme leads in all four nations in Ireland. The reason for that briefing is to make sure that everybody is aware just how high a priority these women. So at every stage in the system, we've also added a computer tag to their records, so that at every stage of the system, as these women work their way, progress their way through the process of checking the situation for them as individuals, they should be prioritised and fast-tracked.
Sandesh Gohani to be followed by Emma Harper.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Thank you to the Minister for advance sight of her statement and a declaration of interest. I'm a practising doctor. My thoughts and prayers go out to the women and their families that have been affected by this terrible error. This is simply awful. It might shake women's faith in the cervical screening programme, and as a GP, I must be clear that attending your cervical screening is vital. I promise you that the swab we take, that I take, performs early warning detection of potential cancer. So please attend your appointment. Do not be put off. Plus, if you experience any symptoms, please contact us and your GP. Minister, is this a failure of coding by the operating surgeon, or is this a more systemic-wide issue, or is it an IT issue?
Minister.
So I thank the member for that question. We've looked, as you might expect, very closely at the points where the errors appear to have occurred, and there are potentially four points where errors have occurred. There has been, for some women, a mismatch between the operation proposed and the operation which was actually done, and that's usually for technical reasons which occurred during the surgery. And as a consequence, a proposed total hysterectomy becomes a subtotal. And that fact might not be noted in the discharge summary, and instead the discharge summary letter will be based on the theatre list, i.e. the planned operation. The GP will see this and request removal from call recall. A second error which has occurred is that subtotal procedures might be incorrectly coded in theatre again, reflecting a mismatch between the proposed and the actual operation, or simply a misunderstanding of what a subtotal procedure actually is. There has also been some incorrect coding in labs, so subtotal specimens might contain some cervical tissue and be incorrectly coded as total hysterectomies when these patients are being considered for continuation on call or recall. And finally, the patient may have been removed from call recall despite accurate information being conveyed to primary care following surgery where the cervix is retained.
Emma Harper to be followed by Carol Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There are many reasons why women might be reluctant to attend their screening tests, ranging from difficulties in attending or being examined due to physical disability, cultural and language barriers, lack of awareness and uneasiness. Can I ask the Minister what action it has taken to break down these barriers and help more women attend their appointment when called?
Minister.
I thank Emma Harper for this question. These are indeed complex issues, and I'm mindful that there is not a single solution, but I also agree that these are very important matters to tackle. I can outline some of the work that's already happening. In initial sample taking training, NHS Education for Scotland provide information for sample takers to help them address the potential issues in assisting disabled people at their cervical screening appointment, along with many other groups where there may be barriers to screening. Further advice for sample takers is also set out in national guidance. If someone's unable to leave their home for a cervical screening appointment, the NHS board can use a multidisciplinary team member to provide support that will allow them to have their sample taken. And this is done on a case-by-case basis, depending on the needs of the individual. The Scottish Government has also made funding available through its Inequality Fund to health boards to allow them to tackle inequalities in access to screening. In addition to the £5 million we've made available over the last 5 years, we'll be exploring how best to use an additional £2 million over the next 2 years to drive long-lasting, sustainable change in the cancer screening programmes. And that will align with the work of the National Screening Oversight, which also has a key focus on tackling inequalities across all of our screening programmes and is developing a strategy to do so.
Carol Mochan, to be followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you. This is obviously a serious failure that must not be allowed to happen again. I would like to ask, on behalf of those women who had subtotal hysterectomies before 1997, to reassure the women, I would like to press for a date that the audit of these cases can be completed. How long will it take for the individuals affected to be contacted? And then finally, where those individuals may have passed on due to complications relating to cervical cancer, will those families be contacted?
Minister.
I thank you for that question. I can assure you that we are working absolutely as fast as we can through these records in order to identify the women who have been wrongly excluded pre-1997. I'm afraid I can't give you an exact date, but we aim to have that work completed by the end of July, and we aim to inform those women as soon as we possibly can. After that, I would expect that to be early August. In terms of women who may be deceased, if we're conducting an audit of all women who have died of cervical cancer, and we will certainly examine whether they are involved in this incident. If they are, the NHS will get in contact proactively with those families in order to explain the situation.
Kenneth Gibson, to be followed by Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Human papillomavirus is known to cause 99% of all cervical cancers, as well as cases of head, neck and anogenital cancers. And so an HPV vaccination programme was introduced for S1 girls in 2008 and boys in 2019. Can the Minister provide an update on how lockdown has affected implementation of the HPV vaccination programme over the last 16 months and how this will be taken forward?
Minister.
I'm afraid I haven't got that data right in front of me. I'm certainly willing to write to the member and update him on that issue as soon as I possibly can get my hands on those figures.
OK, I now call Gillian Mackay to be followed by Christine Graham.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I too would like to extend my sympathies to all of those who have been affected and their families. I note the Minister states that the risk of cervical cancer are low and that cervical screening is the best protection against cervical cancer, but many women's confidence in the programme will have been undermined by today's announcement, particularly when we're hearing more about how women's health problems are being missed, ignored or misdiagnosed. What urgent action will the Minister take to restore confidence in the cervical screening programme and encourage women to continue to attend their appointments?
Minister.
I thank the member for that question. Undoubtedly, we have to ensure that women have confidence in this system. As members have said, it is an extremely effective way of preventing cancer. Around 5,000 lives are saved every year. We just very recently had Cervical Cancer Week. We saw the Scottish Government buildings here in Edinburgh lit up for that. There is regular campaigning conducted by Joe's Trust, Joe's Cervical Cancer Trust, and later in this year we, Scottish Government, will be conducting a campaign to alert women of the practicalities of the screening programme and to highlight just how important it is to have your cervical screening.
Christine Graham, to be followed by Craig Hoy.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I note from the Minister's statement that some of the women are now beyond the eligibility age range from screening, which I think is 64. Not just for those women, but for other women. Can I ask, given that the life expectancy for women in Scotland is over 80, if there's any scope for extending this automatic screening eligibility to at least age 70?
Minister.
I thank the member for that question. At present, screening can extend up to age 70 for those who have a non-routine result that requires follow-up or treatment. So those high-risk women are screened up until the age of 70. The UK NSE keeps the eligible age ranges for screening under review using the best available evidence, and Scottish ministers would, of course, work to implement any change that that committee recommended.
Craig Hoy to be followed by Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I extend my condolences and thoughts to the women and their families who have been affected, and also recognise that for many women and their families, this statement will be a source of significant anxiety. The Minister mentions possible funding. Is she able to say how much funding the Scottish Government has allocated to health boards for extra appointments, and how much has it set aside? And given the obvious anxiety that this will cause to patients, will the Minister consider additional funding for health board level helplines so that patients can inquire about their own records and therefore avoid GP surgeries being possibly but understandably overwhelmed by calls from worried women and their families?
Minister.
Thank you for that question. Four health boards have requested funding to provide additional clinics as follows: Lanarkshire, £28,000, Lothian, £8,098, Greater Glasgow, £5,000, and Fife, £2,700. No other boards have requested funding, but we're happy to keep the situation under review and will provide further funding if needed. We've also provided some extra funding to Joe's Cervical Trust, Cancer Trust. I fully appreciate just how worrying this will be for people who've been affected. Everyone affected will receive a personalised letter from their health board apologising for the situation and providing information about the situation, the incident and the cervical screening. Joe's Cervical Trust have made their helpline available, so that helpline is available nationally for women to call. I would advise against women contacting their GP to find out if they've been affected. I would assure them that anyone who has been identified as incorrectly excluded from the programme because they have a subtotal hysterectomy will receive a letter directly from the health board. Some of them will be asked, those who are within the age range for the screening programme, will be asked to contact their GP to make a screening appointment. The one exception I would give is that our advice remains that people should contact their GP straight away if they experience the symptoms of cervical cancer. And those symptoms are unusual discharge, bleeding after sex, between periods or after the menopause. Those symptoms are generally caused by something else, but it's vitally important that women experiencing those symptoms attend their GP and have them checked out.
Alex Cole-Hamilton to be followed by Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This will be deeply alarming news to many women. It's a tragic reminder of the importance of robust screening programmes. Can I ask the Minister, if there are regular audits, as she says, how this was missed for so long? Why are women only hearing about this now if it was first detected in December 2020? And can I also ask if all of the 1,500 women are aware that their records are currently under review?
Minister.
So, as I explained, the invasive cancer audits, there was new national methodology introduced in 2014, and health boards were doing audits prior to that. In 2020, that new methodology of auditing invasive cervical cancer identified this problem. We have known about, in fact, Scottish Government have only known about this incident since March. The adverse event management team established by the NHS to deal with this issue met for the first time on 9th March and set to work immediately to determine the scope of the incident and how best to support those who were affected. Now, that expert group, as I've said, brings together senior gynaecologists, pathologists and public health experts, as well as senior system leaders in screening, and it established that the immediate priority was to find out how many of those excluded from the cervical screening programme had had a subtotal hysterectomy. Multidisciplinary teams were established in every single one of Scotland's NHS boards, which looked in detail at the medical records of those who had been excluded from the cervical screening programme, despite their records indicating that they had undergone a subtotal hysterectomy. And this was a painstaking process which involved cross-checking a range of electronic and older paper records, including operation notes, pathology reports, hospital discharge letters and GP records, and that took several weeks to complete. And as well as establishing who had been affected, the group also determined that correct care pathways and ensured that arrangements were in place so that everybody receives the same information and the same treatment wherever they are in Scotland. And as I mentioned before, that included making an IT flag, an IT update to flag the records of anyone affected so that any further investigation of treatment required as a result of the incident will be prioritised. That took several weeks to arrange. So I feel it was absolutely vital that the NHS took the time to understand and accurately understand each person's circumstances and making sure that arrangements were in place before we wrote to anyone to make them aware that they might have been excluded in error. To do otherwise, I believe, would have compounded anxiety with long delays or uncertainty about how their cases would be managed.
Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I also extend my sympathies to all those affected. Worrying research conducted by Joe's Cervical Cancer Trust has shown that only half of those who have HPV on their cervical screening results know what it is. With last week being Cervical Screening Awareness Week, can the Minister outline what action can be taken to tackle the stigma and confusion surrounding HPV and increase awareness for women who have been diagnosed and across the wider population?
Minister.
So let me agree with the member that it is absolutely vitally important that we raise awareness of just what HPV is, what it means to have HPV. Joe's Cervical Cancer Trust have told us that HPV is the topic they hear most about through their support helpline, with callers often being confused, anxious or upset about what it means to have it, so that we know that there's more work to help people to understand these issues. NHS Informs already has information to help and support people, and Public Health Scotland regularly does work to raise awareness on issues around cervical screening. And, for example, during Cervical Awareness Week this month, they shared information and posted on social media. The Scottish Government has also funded Joe's Cervical Cancer Trust to carry out work to raise awareness of HPV and its implications for screening, and I expect that that work will pick up pace throughout the year. And finally, as I mentioned, later in the year, we hope to launch our own campaign to raise awareness of cervical screening. We will work to accompany that with wider messaging around HPV.
Miles Briggs to be followed by Paul O'King.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This is indeed a deeply concerning statement, and so I'd like to ask 2 points. Firstly, when were Scottish ministers first made aware of this serious adverse event? And given the fact that, sadly, this is not the first time we've heard of errors in the cervical screening programme, last year NHS National Services Scotland had to apologise for a two-month delay to around 15,000 patients for screening invitation letters due to what they referred to as a technical fault. And given the pressures the NHS is currently under, how are ministers working to reassure women that the programme is fit for purpose? And is the minister also going to look at undertaking a review of this screening programme?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. What I would say is that we've worked really hard. We were first made aware, and as I said this in a previous answer, we were first made aware in March this year, on the 9th of March 2021. Officials were made aware and ministers were also informed on the same day. Everyone involved has worked extremely hard to identify the women involved and to ensure that the systems are corrected so that this error could not be made again going forward, and secondly, to ensure that we could correctly identify the women and contact them with high quality information and provide access to tests and screening at their GP if appropriate, and gynaecological appointments if that was the more appropriate route. At the moment, that is our highest priority, to absolutely ensure that we are completely aware of who is involved and to contact them as quickly as we can and to ensure that they have an appropriate pathway going forward.
And Paul O'Kane.
Thank you. This situation is indeed deeply concerning, and our thoughts, of course, are with all those affected. I appreciate what the Minister has said about funding for the Joe's Trust helpline to support anyone who is concerned, but can she confirm that the funding will last for as long as it is needed and that all sufficient resources will be given to Joe's Trust to ensure comprehensive individual support? But also, further to that support, Can she advise what has been provided to GPs and other health professionals who may be the first point of contact for women but are in the midst of remobilisation from COVID?
Minister.
I thank the member for that question. It enables me to put on record that I am extremely grateful to Joe's Cervical Cancer Trust for running their helpline. They have enormous expertise in supporting people who may have questions and concerns around screening or the risk of cervical cancer. We have given them extra funding to ensure that they can cope with the extra calls that we anticipate. We'd be more than happy to discuss with them should they require more funding. As I mentioned, the letters to the women affected who have been wrongly excluded from the programme went out on Tuesday. At the same time, letters went directly to their GPs. The letters to the women not only had details personal to them, but had an information leaflet with general information and frequently asked questions for women. The similar format was covered for the GPs, so we sent the GPs information and we also sent them a set of Q&As. And as I listed in a previous answer, we have contacted very many people within the health boards and various colleges, at Royal Colleges of different professions, to ensure that everyone who women might ask, as far as we possibly can, everyone who women might ask questions about their own situation will be well armed with information to reassure them and give them confidence that their care is in safe hands.
Thank you, Minister. We will have a short pause to allow for changeover of PO before we move on to the next item of business. Thank you.